Retro.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to this fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. This is the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Jay, before we start talking about The Mandalorian, can you remind everyone where they can find us around the internet?
We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust, and we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So today we are talking about The Mandalorian Chapter 12, The Siege, and this is, as always, a full spoiler discussion. This episode is written by Jon Favreau and directed by Carl Weathers. With that said, Jay, can you go ahead and give everyone a summary of the episode?
Indeed. Unable to complete sufficient repairs on the Razor Crest, the Mandalorian returns to Nevarro. When he arrives, he is greeted by old friends Greef, Karga, and Cara Dune. They have cleaned up the city, but they need his help. While the Razor Crest undergoes repairs, the child is left in a school, and Din Djarin, Cara Dune, Greef Karga, and Mithral, the bounty from Chapter 1, head to a nearby Imperial base. If they can destroy the base, they can make the entire planet safe and bring stability to the region. Infiltrating the base is more difficult than anticipated, though. It is well garrisoned, but they manage to drain the coolant from the reactor and set it on a path of overheating and exploding. As they make their escape, they come across a secret lab and find a mysterious creature preserved in a tank, along with a recording from Dr. Pershing to Moff Gideon explaining the need for more blood from the child and why the experiment failed. The Mandalorian uses his jetpack to get back to the city to protect the child, while Cara, Greef, and Mithral fight their way out of the base and commandeer an Imperial transport. They fight off scout troopers on speeder bikes, but just when it appears they will be overrun by TIE fighters, the Mandalorian arrives in the newly repaired Razor Crest to save the day. He and the child can't stick around and have to keep moving. The episode concludes with Moff Gideon receiving word from one of the technicians that repaired the Razor Crest that a tracking beacon had been installed. Before the credits roll, Gideon is seen supervising work on what appears to be mysterious large black armored droids.
So I had no idea what kind of work Carl Weathers could do as a director, but I was thoroughly impressed after watching this episode. What is your overall thought on this one?
I agree. And I feel that the pacing on this was very well done. There was a lot of really great action. There was so much visual to this. There was, once again, you know, just that great Star Wars humor in all the right places. And really captivated my attention big time. So two big thumbs up for Carl Weathers. Very impressive.
Yeah, absolutely. So there's plenty of things to discuss with this. And that summary you read for us was a very high level description of what happened in this episode. And it's just chock full of great moments. Starting with the very beginning of the episode is the Razor Crest is limping along to Corvus. And the Mandalorian is trying to guide the child through switching some wires in a little shaft off the cockpit. And there he is, the child's back there trying to figure out which wire is blue, trying to figure out which wire is red, and what the Mandalorian is telling him to do to put them back in the socket. Mandalorian keeps telling them not to let them touch each other because they're reverse charge. And of course, what happens, they end up touching each other and the child gets a jolt there. You and I frequently talk about this, and our listeners are probably quite tired of hearing us say it, but we talk about the Star Wars humor. And what is Star Wars humor here? This was it. This was fantastic. It was a clever and cute scene without going overboard.
I agree. And what I think was just so darling about this whole thing was you get that patience from Din, you know, no, put the red wire where the blue wire was. And you could tell he was trying to be so patient. But all I could think of was, this is a loose wire joke. You know, it goes back to Revenge of the Sith. We got a loose wire joke.
Well, the other thing about it is that you have a guy wearing a mask. So his facial expressions are not coming through, which I think would have been incredibly useful to the child to understand, because he had to over-exaggerate with his hands to get his meaning across there. And the child was doing his best, and he understood some of what the Mandalorian was saying, because he was holding up a wire, show me the red wire. And so the child holds it up, and there it is. But again, a cute scene. They did some really great work with the child in this episode, and we'll get to some more of that here in just a bit. But the next thing we see is Cara Dune invading the lair of the Aqualish, who seem to be these thugs or gangsters that have been robbing and stealing from the citizens of Nevarro. And we learn a couple things. One, she is the marshal of the town. And two, they're in the old lair of the armorer underneath the city. And we get to see that crest above the door as the camera pounds down in there. And then we get to see her forge in the background.
And all I could think of is, how sad is that the armorer had to leave there? Because we just know from the first season that was, you know, her lair, of course, but it was her home too. And it just seemed so, almost in a way, haunted because she wasn't there.
Yeah. And it's an interesting development, because as we see over the course of this episode, Nevarro is stabilized for the most part. The last thing they need to do is get rid of this Imperial base. So it's not like the Empire was really there to hunt her anymore. So she chose to leave. It was her decision to do that. It's not necessarily that she was forced to do. So I'm kind of wondering where we're going to see her next.
Well, that was my next question to you, is do you think we will end up seeing her again? I hope that we do, but do you think we will?
Oh, absolutely. I think at some point in the future of this series, I don't know if it's even this season, but season 3, season 4, there is going to be a reckoning between Bo-Katan and her Night Owls and the Watch, the Children of the Watch, as some people are calling them. Mm-hmm. And I kind of think that Din Djarin was swayed a bit by what Bo-Katan had to say in the last episode. And the armor is going to have some questions to answer when it comes to that.
Well, I agree with you. And we were talking about how Din might be having this sort of identity crisis kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering if the armor is a little bit more higher up, I guess you could say, in the Watch than maybe we ever really realized. And from what you just said, I could see where that would be kind of a battle of wits, you know, or a battle of values when it comes right down to it.
Well, and the Mandalorian told Bo-Katan last episode that he was tasked with returning the child to the Jedi by a Mandalorian armor. So that seems to be a position of respect and a title that other Mandalorians would be expected to recognize there. So I definitely think that that is an influential person. Then there'll be, I just don't see how she doesn't show up again in the future of this series, whether it's in a direct conflict with the Mandalorian, something that stands in the way of Bo-Katan accomplishing what she's trying to do, or maybe it's even a spinoff series. I have no idea, but we'll see.
Mm-hmm.
So back in Nevarro, they land there, and Greef Karga and Cara Dune greet the Mandalorian, and they make some comments about his ship. The rear landing, the door doesn't go all the way down, and so he needs some repairs. Greef is happy to basically just do them, have them done for him. There's a Mimbanian technician there that's going to help make the repairs. And Greef is really excited to see the child. I mean, talks to him, pure grandfather
Oh, yeah.
On that
scene. Definitely. That was so adorable. And again, like you said, with Carl Weathers directing this, he was all about this. And what a complete 180 from where he was in season one. I just feel like his character arc has developed in such a fun way and an endearing way, really.
Right. And Cara Dune's no longer a mercenary. She's the marshal of the town. And between the two of them, they clean the place up. And when they get into the city, the streets are full of people selling things kind of like in a bazaar, and it's a lot cleaner, a lot brighter. There's a statue of IG-11 in the background, which was really cool. I don't know if he's caught that.
I didn't even catch that. No, I have to go back.
Yes. As they are entering the former cantina that is now serving a school, if you look behind them in the distance, there's a statue of IG-11. And so that was a nice touch. But that's the other thing. The cantina where Greef Karga was doing his business as leader of the Bondsman Guild is now a school. And it's being led by a protocol droid. So they're going to leave the child there to basically be babysat while they go off on this mission. Did you catch anything that the protocol droid was teaching the kids?
Well, I went back. I took a cue from you, and I went back and watched it with the closed captioning. And she was talking about all of the different trade routes and things. But it's been a couple of days since I've rewatched it. So, is there something specific that you're getting at?
Oh, not particularly. I just thought it was neat, the attention to detail. They were talking about how the capital of the Empire was on Coruscant, but the Republic has now moved it to Chandrilla. They talked about the maelstrom that surrounds Kessel. Mm-hmm. The Hidian Way gets mentioned a few times. They have a conversation about the inner, the mid, and the outer rims of the galaxy. So it was just kind of a Star Wars geeks classroom right there. It was all these stuff that we know, and it's just kind of this background chatter that's going on while the child is stealing the blue macaroons from the other kid.
Yeah. And okay, so I love a couple of things about this. One, Star Wars in the classroom is now canon. Yes. And I just thought that it was really kind of impressive the way that they took something that is so earthly as a classroom, but yet still made it feel like Star Wars in that way. They took something so earthly, like a classroom, with these kids sitting in these rows, and they had all of these different globes. And I love the fact that they had all the different globes, you know, of the different planets and whatnot. And these kids that were trying to pay attention, maybe paying attention, the little girl with the Ray buns. Did you see that?
Yeah. Yeah.
That was adorable. And then, of course, you know, the child looking at the little boy with the blue macaroons, which I thought was interesting. There's a couple things. One about these macaroons, if you looked at the concept art at the very, very end, they were just little biscuit looking kind of things. Mm-hmm. And they sort of took on a life of their own. And some people were joking that they must have had a contract with William Sonoma because they're selling them for like $50 a dozen now.
Yeah. Steep.
A little bit. I'm going to make my own. Thank you very much. But the other thing, too, just kind of bouncing back to that little ferret-like thing or meerkat-like thing. In the concept art, they showed it blowing fire. Did you notice that?
Yeah, I did. I did. So apparently they had a script revision at some point.
Yeah, but that would have made so much sense because it's the armorer's pet and she deals with fire. I don't know. I just feel like that might have been a missed opportunity. But getting back to the classroom, I was enchanted by that. I just thought it was awesome.
Yeah, and I love how the blue macaroons come up again later. I kind of feel like Oreo should have got in on this and had some sort of blue icing dipped Oreos that would have conveyed about the same thing you could have gotten for $8 or $9 as opposed to paying $50 for a dozen macaroons from William Sonoma. I'm glad someone is making these available to fans because some people will buy them, but that just seems a bit extreme for me for a dozen cookies.
I agree. And I will admit, I did go to my local grocery store to see if I could find some in our bakery there, and they didn't have any available. But like I said, I can make my own. They do take a little time, but you have about maybe, well, less than $10 in ingredients in a dozen of them.
Mm-hmm. So the Mithril, or Mithril, as we've come to know, I thought Mithril was the race name, but it's turns out to be the character's name, or as they do with Mandalorian, they're just referring to this guy by his affiliation, his race. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The bounty from chapter one is waiting in Greef Karga's office. And it turns out Greef had actually put the bounty on this guy for running off for some creative accounting. And so Greef is now giving him the opportunity to work off his debt, which I can't say is a complete character reversal for Greef Karga, but it's getting him along that path. But Mithril is going to have to help the Mandalorian, Cara Dune, and Greef Karga take out this Imperial base. And the pitch that Greef and Cara make to the Din Djarin is that this Imperial base is basically everything that stands in the way from Nevarro, the planet, stabilizing and from making this a hub of commerce in this sector. And if they can get rid of this base, then they'll be throwing off these Imperial shackles. And at first I was like, oh, really? Because this is talking about the Empire. But of course, the Empire's fallen at this point. We're talking about a remnant of the Empire. And so it makes sense. They couldn't necessarily come back and refortify this position. Mm-hmm. To his credit, it does not take much convincing for the Mandalorian to do this. As soon as Greef says, look, it's going to take some time to get your ship fixed. You've got time. Come help us do it. And the most reluctant person in the room is Mithril.
Right. Yes. Because as soon as he walked in, Din walked in and he saw him, he almost did like an inking, you know, yeah, like what a squid would do. And so I just thought that was a really ingenious way to work in some of the alien type, I guess you could say, habits that they may have when it comes to being stressed out or whatever.
Yeah. So they head off to this Imperial base, and again, some clever moments here with this episode. They kind of go through this obsidian or ashen valley, might be a better way of describing it, and they arrive at the base, and then the elevator's not working, and so Greef tells Mithril to get out of the speeder and bring, I can't remember what the name of the tool is, but it looks like a welding device, to try and slice open the lift. And then the Mandalorian takes off in his jetpack, throws a stormtrooper over the edge, and then he sends the lift down for them. And it turns out the base is a lot more fortified than Greef and Cara lit on or knew, similarly to how in Chapter 8, there was more than four stormtroopers waiting in the city for them when they showed up. And they set about invading the base. You said it earlier in your overall impressions about the episode, but this was just so well paced. They gave us information during the course of it. They worked in nods to so many other Star Wars properties during the course of it. And they never, ever let it get slow. It is such high adrenaline from this point out on the rest of the episode.
I totally agree with you. And there's so many substantial things that happen, one right after the other, that you miss it almost the first time around. And I found myself rewinding this segment several times to try to catch everything.
Right. And yeah, right off the bat, they fight their way off to the reactor control, which is a spitting image for the tractor beam controls on the Death Star in A New Hope. So that was a nice touch. And Mithril has to kind of crawl out there on that little catwalk around the side and turn off the coolant so that the lava that's kind of powering things will overflow and blow up the base, and he's very reluctant to do so. And then as they make their way back into the base, they've got about 10 minutes. They're trying to evade the stormtroopers as much as they can, as opposed to taking them head on, but they end up in the lab. And as soon as the two technicians come into view, Greef and Cara and the Mandalorian start shooting back at them, and off to the side of the frame behind the doorway, you can see someone wearing a t-shirt and jeans.
Yes, I saw, I didn't notice it at first, but I saw it like blew up the internet, and people were even putting things on, you know, like action figures, carded action figures of t-shirt and jeans guy. And
yeah, my favorite one is the character poster of t-shirt guy that's in the same style that they did for all the characters that have come out for the show.
I haven't seen that one.
Yeah. But yeah, it's there. And if you want to go back and see it yourself, if you freeze it at 18 minutes and 54 seconds, you can see it. So blooper aside, I find this a very minor blemish on an otherwise outstanding episode. The technicians that are there in the lab realize they're being invaded. And one of them says to the others, like, wipe out all the data logs. And then they start blowing up the consoles before they arrive there. And then when these guys are shot, that's when Din Djarin, Greef, Cara, and Mithril notice everything that's around them. So there are these tanks, and it's dark, and it's hard to see exactly what's in them. But then Mithril plays this message, and it's from Dr. Pershing, and it's talking about how they could only take a limited amount of the blood from the child. The trials resulted in a catastrophic failure. They had promising results for Fortnite, but then the body rejected the blood. He doubts that they can find another donor with a higher M count. Mm-hmm. And he's recommending that they suspend all experimentation because he fears the volunteer will suffer the same fate if they proceed with the transfusion. Again, they've exhausted their initial supply of the blood, so they're just kind of out of luck until they can get back the child back on this. I paused it when we got a look of what was in the tank, and I've got multiple thoughts as to what this might be. But what did you think we were saying?
There's so much going on right here. Number one, I was thinking it was Snoke's in a jar, or at least, mm-hmm. you know, something similar. But my mind was wondering after that, though, because Pershing said the donors or the volunteers. So mm-hmm. I'm wondering if there were different beings that were being used and they were trying things out on different types of species, different types of beings. Because I was trying to think if, you know, see and zoom in to see if all of the forms in these jars, these tanks, were of the same type of being. One of them definitely did look like Snoke to me.
Sure.
But there were a few other ones that I couldn't exactly tell. And I was wondering if maybe they were different species. But what did you think?
So when I freeze framed it in a couple places, there's only two tanks that you have any shot of really seeing what's in there. And it's only the one that I kind of thought looked like a failed proto Snoke mm-hmm. that I could make any type of detail out on at all. I'm beginning to wonder if that's not a red herring because like you said, the use of the word volunteers
right
there. And so is the plan to try and make these people force sensitive, and that's why they needed the blood from the child because he has such a high M count, which I can only believe mm-hmm. in midichlorians.
Gotta be. Oh yeah.
And then we have a scene at the end of this episode, which we'll get to in just a second, but that kind of makes me think that maybe more along the lines of what we're talking about here. But I've had a pet theory ever since the child showed up and we knew Moff Gideon was looking for him, or that there was this client, Werner Herzog character, was looking for him, that it was trying to get the genetics of the child or the blood of the child in the hopes of recovering midichlorians to play in the resurrection of the Emperor, because that's what I came up with this theory after The Rise of Skywalker when we knew the Emperor was back and how mm-hmm. he came back, that maybe this was the early stages of that plan. Mm-hmm. So who knows? It's hard to say. But you want to talk about one of the most unexpected, tantalizing, intriguing details. That was
yes.
full stop. Just my jaw dropped open when I saw all of that. It was just wow. I did not expect any type of that. I did not expect anything like that type of a clue at this stage of the series.
No, especially not on Nevarro. Mm-hmm. And especially given what they were trying to do, there was, yeah, that was the last thing that I would have thought that they would run across. But yeah, full stop, both mentally and literally in the scene itself, as you said. And I just think, as you said, there's so many different nods to different types of things in Star Wars in here. And the fact that Dr. Pershing mentioned the M count and didn't say midichlorian, I'm not sure how I feel about that. Because I know, like we've talked about before, and of course in the fandom, everyone knows that there's always been this debate about midichlorians. And we were just talking about this with Dan Zierer as far as the living force versus the cosmic force and, you know, the use of midichlorians in there and that type of thing. But I don't know, this whole thing is, it's riveting. I mean, it's blows your mind. It really does.
Sure. I didn't have a problem with the M count because that sounded like typical scientific jargon that would be used to abbreviate something, mm-hmm. because M count is easier to say than midichlorian count. And that would be something that would be expected and an easy way of talking to everyone else that's in that lab. And so for me, at least, that granted a certain degree of realism. And I really don't know what else it could be. We all know who the child is. He is this force sensitive child. He's got extraordinary force powers for someone as young as he is. He exhibits quite a bit of ability there. We know that's why he's valuable to the Empire. So I'm not sure what else that concept could possibly be. Mm-hmm. By saying it that way, they open it up for discussion and possibly pull the rug out from underneath us later. But I don't know what to what end they would be doing that.
Well, and also the music that was playing at the time, too, was the Emperor's or the Imperial, you know, Sith music kind of thing. So there's right. that clue.
Yeah, it wasn't a perfect match. But
No. But you get the tone.
Right, and it sounded like a little bit of the Imperial themes kind of strike. I don't know how to talk about music expertly, so please forgive me. But mm-hmm. some of the Imperial tones kind of like stretched out and made mm-hmm. in minor keys and made very creepy sounding. So, there's definitely some possibilities there. I'm eager to see what they do with that. We have so many different things going on in the show right now and that they've been teasing us this, and we know they're coming up. I'm really curious to see where and how this fits in and when mm-hmm. this fits in.
Okay, I'm glad to see Dr. Pershing back. I really am. Yeah. He looks very, almost afraid to give that news in some ways.
He and is this the transition. Has,
oh, yeah. He's all of this kind of gives me that sense, that flavor of the novel Darth Plagueis, too. I get that sense just from this whole ambiance that's going on.
Exactly. So at this point, the Mandalorian realizes he's got to get back to the child as soon as possible, because if the Empire knows that they're there, the child is vulnerable. And so Cara Dune says, take your jetpack. That's the fastest way back. And then they'll fight their way out. And that's exactly what happens. The Mandalorian goes back to that lava shaft. He flies to the top, does a hero landing outside, the end of Iron Man 3-point landing, mm-hmm. and then shoots a stormtrooper and then takes off for Nevarro. Meanwhile, Cara, Greef, and Mithril commandeer that transport. It looks kind of like a prototype version of the classic Imperial transport that we've seen in Chapter 8 of the series and in episodes of Rebels.
Right.
And they try to drive it into the base, but the door slams down, so Cara drives it over the cliff, and they land in the valley, where they immediately get pursued by scout troopers on speeder bikes. Two of them crash, and then one of them gets shot by Greef Karga using the turret that's in the speeder. Cara rams one into wall, and then the third one ends up on top of the speeder. And just as he's about to drop a grenade, Greef Karga discovers where he is and shoots him in the back. And then we've got the TIE fighter pursuit, which seemed like a bit of a callback to the trench run from A New Hope, the way that that all went down, mm-hmm. with the Mandalorian showing up the last second, doing his best Han impression without going Yahoo, and shooting one of the TIE fighters as they're getting a lock there on the thing. Just edge of your seat type of action there. It was so incredibly well done.
It was so good. It really was. I mean, I can't say anything more than what you've already said, other than just the little nods here and there, even to some humor mm-hmm. with the one stormtrooper kind of falling down the levels as the other two stormtroopers watch him fall.
Yeah. Even further.
I mean, that was awesome. And then just how those scout troopers, their bikes ran into each other and just careened off of each other was awesome. I mean, it's just, there were so many little things and so many little touches in here. And like you said, just the poetry with the trench run and the Razor Crest almost being like Han coming in at that last second was just, it was so great.
And how great was it seeing the Razor Crest and fully functional after so many chapters?
Oh yeah. You know how much I love this ship. I really do.
You and I are both big fans. And then going head to head with the last two TIE fighters, with the child getting all excited in the cockpit, Mandalorian tells him to hold on, kid. And the child, every time he blows something up, has got his hands up his head. Yay! Chewing on more blue macaroons. Then finally, you know, there's a lot of spinning going on. When it's all over, the child spits up some of a digested macaroon. And Din Djarin leans over and wipes up his chin and his robes with his cape.
That was so adorable. It really was. I love how he said, I've got some onboard maintenance to do.
Yes.
That was why.
Right. And so he can't stop and let Greef buy him a drink. Mm-hmm. But they're even now because basically he traded his services with help destroying the base for the repairs. Yeah. Fantastic action scene. I'm not sure what else really needs to be said about it. But then we get to the end where the Mimbanian repair tech calls into Greef Karga's light cruiser and speaks to the comm officer about having installed the tracking beacon on the ship as was requested. And so she tells him that you'll be rewarded in the new order. And then she goes to report to Moff Gideon. And he takes the report. And as we're heading out to credits, we see him supervising work on what appear to be these large black armored droid type things or mech suits. I'm not exactly sure. When I saw this, the first thing that came to mind was the Dart Troopers from the old Dart Forces game that introduced Kyle Katarn to the Star Wars Legends universe.
Okay. See, my mind didn't go there. I was thinking Death Troopers, but I didn't really get a very good look at them. So now that you say that, though, I can completely see that.
See, the reason I didn't go to Death Troopers is that we've already seen Death Troopers in the series, and they aren't as tall as these things, these constructs we saw sitting in the bays. And what were in the bays were completely immobile. They were not moving. And we had all these technicians looking over them. A couple other things about them. The Dark Troopers from Dark Forces came in three different phases. There was phase one, phase two, and phase three. And as you progress through all of them, they had heavier armaments, more armor, and they were more lethal. These look something more along the lines of the phase two, phase three type of a thing. We know Dave Filoni is involved in the production of this entire series. I would not put it past him to bring these things in here now. This seems like something that's right, would be right up his sleeve to do it, especially if John said, "Hey, Dave, I've got some super soldier I want to introduce here." And Dave would tell him the Dark Troopers would be the way to go. The other thing about it is that in the Dark Forces game, the Dark Troopers were not force sensitive. They were droids through and through. However, in some of the other Legends material, and mainly video games, they were frequently described as being force-sensitive cyborgs. And so perhaps these things are tied to what was going on to Nevarro, and that's what the reference to volunteers is that they're needing soldiers that have some sort of force-sensitive sensitivity to use this armor that Moff Gideon is working on. Just a theory. Oh,
goodness. No, that is you've got me mesmerized, because that makes so much more sense than what I was thinking. Because like I said, I just thought maybe, oh, they were, you know, Death Troopers that they were modifying with something. But I love your theory. I think that makes so much more sense.
Yeah, it's a theory. I mean, I'm kind of hoping more towards the Snoke thing. I think it would be awesome to see the early stages of the development of Snoke, because although we've gotten more information about him in the Age of Resistance Supreme Leader Snoke comic and in the Kylo Ren comic and the Rise of Kylo Ren comics and things like that, we still don't have all the origins for Snoke. The one thing that works against the Snoke theory for me is assuming everyone is paying attention, from the story group to Jon Favreau, Dave Filoni, Charles Soule, who wrote the Rise of Kylo Ren, is that when in that Rise of Kylo Ren series, when Ben Solo fled to Snoke's space station, which was built on this edge of a dark side nexus, Ben makes the comment, "Snoke, look what Master Skywalker did to you." And so Snoke's deformities were blamed on something that Luke did. Whereas I was getting the impression from what we're seeing here in these tanks that the way that these characters were deformed was a result of the experimentation itself. So
that's what I would have went to.
Yeah. So it's a little unclear, but I'm sure they've got this all figured out. I love this episode because, again, there's so much great action, and it builds on so much stuff that came before, but then it throws out so many possibilities and so many things for us to talk about, think about, and speculate about.
Oh, absolutely. And also what I think is just so striking about all of this is the fact that, as you said, you know, some of these origins of Snoke and that type of thing, and some of these other things that were actually covered in this particular chapter, they do show up in other media, but I just love the fact that they're plugging this into, you know, I hate to say mainstream, but Mandalorian is more mainstream than probably anything else Star Wars right now. And so you don't have to be that, you know, uber saturated kind of fan that's into all of these other media, like the comics and the games and that type of thing, that this is kind of your one-stop shop to be able to revel in it all and to be able to make those connections make sense. And that's what I appreciate so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm really eager to see what happens next. I don't know that we're going to see these devices or droids or dark troopers or whatever they may be next chapter, because they've done a very good job of teasing something and then not getting back to it for a couple chapters later. So we'll see when these come up again. But they just, when I think every chapter I've seen this season can't be beat, they top it with the next one. And so there are, they at least put out something equally as good. It's been consistently good this season. So kudos to Favreau, Filoni, and that entire team over there.
Yes.
But did you have any other final thoughts on this chapter before we wrap it up?
Well, just the way that it ended when the X-Wing fighter Blue is what Kara called him, when he showed up to question about what had happened. And, Greef is playing like, I don't know what's going on, and I'll let you know if anything turns up. And then he goes out there and he talks to Kara about, you're from Alderaan. Did you lose anyone? And she said, I lost everyone. And then he lays that thing on the table. Mm-hmm. And, I was unsure as to what that was. Was that, was it something from Alderaan? Was he from Alderaan? Because he said, I was at Alderaan. But
yeah, he said he served during Alderaan. Right. I wasn't sure exactly what that meant. Yeah, that was Captain Carson Teva, who we saw back in the second chapter of the season. And I asked that question too on our Discord channel, which was, what exactly was it he left behind? It looked like it could have been a medal, or a rebellion or New Republic medal. It seemed like it possibly could have been some sort of a communication device because he was trying to recruit her. I don't know. It could be something that we never see again. And I also think it's something that we could see Cara Dune pulling out when they're in a tough spot to make a communication later this season. So
I never even would have thought that it was a communicator, but that makes a lot of sense, because he was saying we could use someone like you, and kind of left it behind as a token of, you change your mind, here you go.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, this series has a way of leaving some things with ambiguity, I think. And so that we are wondering what they are, and then they can be pulled out when we don't exactly remember them later in the series. So yeah, definitely a good drop there. So we'll see.
And just, a couple of their thoughts too, is that, as you said, the way that they're circling around some of these different things that they present, and then they just kind of leave it there for you to think about, which gives us a lot of ammunition for discussion, of course, which is amazing. But I also really love how this series has made the things that go on between these huge action scenes very relatable. Things like Din sipping soup with the child, on board, and just lifting his helmet just enough to take his sip of soup. And then you could see the child looking up at him, very curious, almost, like a child trying to maybe shake a present on their birthday to find out what's in it. And he's obviously very enthralled by what's underneath there. So I'm wondering if that's a little bit of foreshadowing, even with him kind of just slowly just lifting that a little bit. But it's also very practical because he has to eat sometime. But, there's just little things like that I just think are, like I said, they're just very relatable. And I just really appreciate those kinds of things.
Yeah, the typical parent-child mimicry that happens right there. So, all right. Well, then, I think that'll do it for our review of Chapter 12 of The Mandalorian. I'd like to thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust. And we'd like to remind you that we are part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Overcast, Amazon Music, or wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts, including the RetroZap podcast feed. And just a couple more things. First, don't forget to head over to Apple Podcasts and leave a 5-star rating review if you haven't already done so. We appreciate everyone who has taken the time to help us out with that. And second, please make sure to tell your friends that are interested in Star Wars or about our show, and or just give us a shout out on social media. Tell us about an episode that you liked and what we talked about or your thoughts on it. That kind of word of mouth is one of the best ways that you can help get the word out about podcast artists and everything we're doing here out to others. And with that in mind, Jay, could you remind everybody one more time where they can find us on social media and around the internet?
Sure. We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Artist. And if you'd like to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can always check out our Pinterest page and our YouTube channel, and you can always email us your thoughts at podcastartist@retrozap.com. And if dropping emails is just not your cup of soup, you can always join us on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server. And you can also support us on TeePublic, where we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And you can find tons and tons of products over there. And you know, the holidays are coming, and who couldn't use some Podcast Stardust swag? And there's everything from phone cases and masks, t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, you name it. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all those great designs.
All right. That'll do it then for episode 184 of Podcast Artists. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.